The real sad thing is, before we go forward, real sad thing is, no one celebrated Harambe's like death. There was no like 1 year anniversary.
Oh, shit. When was that?
Exactly.
Oh, shit out of him.
Like no one cared.
He was big when he got shot. I wasn't about Harambe when it happened, so I'm not the person.
Nah. I'm just saying the internet didn't do anything. Mm-hmm. Anyway, all right.
I love how you took that moment to call out the internet. Like anyone that could be listening, just like listen, you bitches. So Harambe, they're like,
how dare you?
Nobody can fit you, whack motherfuckers. You could make all these
you
memes.
Feel bad.
You could make all these memes, but then the death passes and you got nothing to say, really?
Yeah.
No dicks out for Harambe the next year.
The disrespect.
Harambe was forgotten.
Yeah,
Harambe was forgotten.
Damn,
look at that. That's what I'm saying. All right. 3, 2, 1. Hey, what's going on, ladies and gentlemen? We are the Art School Rejects.
Nigga, he did the countdown.
Oh my god!
There was somebody mentioned Harambe, and I have a green banana drop.
Oh my god!
Every time it's like the first time. Oh, so. We got some awesome guests here, some classic Art School Reject veterans. I'll call them out. We have James.
Yo, what's up?
And we have Gavin.
Gavin.
Yeah, I said your name.
Gavin.
You say what's up. Anyway, and we have Carlos.
Damn, the record stopped.
Somebody took that away from him.
So I was like, you invited who?
I'm here. My bad.
And you have Shay, who's myself. And, all right.
Yeah, we're here. Episode 32. Black Mirror.
32? All right. Black Mirror.
Museum.
That's what we're talking about.
Black Mirror. We got three black guys. Makes sense.
Whoa.
Hey, man. Why are you calling me out? What's happening?
Government doesn't need to know those things.
They didn't know.
I've still put other on my race when they ask me that type of stuff. I just like to throw it in there.
I never fill it out. On applications, you got to meet me.
You can be getting all types of wick.
Yeah. <laughs> You're not kidding. All right. So this episode, we're talking about Black Mirror.
Season four?
Season four? Yeah.
We can talk about all the seasons. I am ready to go.
I mean, the last one just dropped over the Christmas.
It came out like right before the New Year's.
Yeah, right before New Year's. Yeah. Good time, actually.
2017, so this is already old news.
Yeah.
Not everybody watches it immediately, though.
Yeah, I don't, man. I took
my time with it, actually. I didn't binge it like the first weekend or whatever. I kind of, you know what? Here's the thing about Black Mirror. I can't watch more than one episode a day.
No, I
watch one and then I need the whole rest of the day to process
it. Yeah, that's what I thought you were gonna say. That's why I laughed. It was like, nah, I gotta really think about this shit. This is dark.
Well, sometimes it's dark, but lately it seems like there's been like some optimistic episodes.
Yeah, it's been a really hopeful season. I was surprised.
Really?
Yeah, especially season four. I think
for Black Mirror, yeah.
Yeah, I think you know what I really think it is. I want to pinpoint it and say it's definitely a Netflix thing, and I think it's because of the American audience
that they're
pandering a little bit to that side instead of just the bleak fucking like UK audience, well, where they're used to that.
It was getting real Japanese. it was like those movies where it's just like so. At the end of this, no one made it out okay. Like,
yeah,
the end. Like,
Grave of the Fireflies-ing us,
right?
Just
constantly,
just making you the saddest you can be. Like, hey, there's no future.
I kind of like it though because it makes me desensitized to other movie bullshit. So when like movie shit is happening and there's a character worried, I'm like, this isn't as bad as Audition. Like, you'll be fine. Like, you're not gonna like it.
Like, so well, very, very little things are as bad as auditions. there isn't much going. Like, you know that I still have not played that for Saiyan. Yo, it's like, yeah, I'm not sure.
He would never date.
It's like, you know what? Like, because we watch everything. Yeah. We watched Requiem for a Dream recently. We watched Old Boy.
That's a good movie. You know, like, Old Boy's great right up until that moment. Oh, boy.
You know, yeah. You know what, though? I feel like those movies.
Audition is still locked away for now. It's like.
I got to show you this when you're 20, son. Like, you're going
to. Yeah. Maybe next year.
I mean, imagine if they had to do that. That audition movie, like, a little bit more updated, but instead of it being like audition, it was kind of like Tinder.
So an updated audition would be, yeah, a dating app.
Tinder.
Yeah.
Tinder, the movie. Man. He swiped right once.
Oh, man. Wrong. I don't like it.
But you do know, like, a lot of people have that fear already that, you know, you're going to go on a Tinder date and, you know, next thing you know, you're going to wake up in a fucking bathtub with ice in your, you know, your sutures are like coming out, like your kidneys are missing.
Yeah. And we didn't see like anything that bad in Hang the DJ. Like the algorithm doesn't match you with like a mass murderer.
Yeah. Right. I kept waiting for somebody to be an actual monster. Like, I was like, okay, one of these is going to punch her in the face. Like, I kept waiting for that to happen and it never did, and I was like, oh, thank you, Vladimir. Yeah. Thanks for not ruining
Life. I mean, the worst of it was like that chick that was like the tiki masala, like
she was just
the garlic breath.
Yeah, just like, why would it even like it, I think the app was just like, okay, now we need to find your absolute rock bottom of a decent relationship. Like, you need to date the worst person who you wouldn't actually necessarily leave because she'd scare you too much.
I would have went the other way, like, you know, so obviously at the end of Hang the DJ you're forced to kind of break the rules and rebel against the system that you're kind of trapped into, and I think if I would have been with that one girl, I would have went the opposite way. I would have kind of broke the system, but instead of
you left by yourself
instead of leaving with her, I would have just like broken out of it.
I like the idea that you answer like 50 questions and at the end of it, it's just like, oh, you're asexual, because just like it keeps trying to part you with terrible people.
What's his name? Frank?
Yeah, Frank was the guy's name.
Like, there is that moment where he's what if the system just like randomly pairs you? There isn't no rhyme or reason to it. It just randomly pair you with people until you just get demoralized and you give up, and then you finally end up with somebody and the rest of your life you're just left second guessing it.
Yeah,
which is actually just like real life.
Yeah, right. But like, so what was the deal with the way it was working? Because for him it was like, let me put you in a terrible relationship for 9 months with a girl you don't get along with at all. For her it was, let me put you in a relationship and you will just like kind of get tired of his annoying idiosyncrasies, but then you're gonna be banging so many dudes. Like, like, what was that about?
I think that was going for some real life accuracy, James. I feel like I've seen a few relationships go in that direction.
Well, me too, but like,
I mean, like real. That's real.
That's just like, she just went on like a Tinder spree, basically.
Pretty much, right? Like,
but I think it did a good job of like kind of putting that in there and making it relatable to our lives, some of the dating apps that we actually use and what actually transpires. But then also like not making it seem like a bad thing. Oh. Like, they weren't like judgmental about it.
True. Yeah, they weren't slut-shaming. Yeah. I was just going to say, though, also, I think you're supposed to assume that on the opposite end, he's doing the exact same thing. Like, he's not with the same girl for too long. It's like, they just show this one really bad relationship, but he's doing the same as her.
Well, no,
and it's
but
not
like,
even really them doing it, because it's like their program algorithm versions of themselves.
Yeah.
So it's like the person that you would escape this whole thing with is the person you're like meant to be with, or that you match the most with.
Wasn't that like a whole thing, though, where like they had slightly different durations in their relationships? So like she finished before him and then it was just like every 36 hours you get another dude. And then like for him, it was just one terrible relationship the whole time.
Like a half.
Well, he had multiple long ones, but
yeah, we actually don't know.
We don't see like everything. They just go into like hers a little bit more because she says like,
Yeah, I actually like that
transition. Of her going through different
people. I actually really like that transition because it starts out about him. And then, like, halfway through, we transition and it becomes about her.
Also, that episode is a really nice break considering how this season goes down. Like, that is a really nice in-between, like, oh, okay, the world of Black Mirror isn't so horrifying. Like,
it was the San Junipero of season
four. Yeah,
yeah, it was.
Yeah.
But I didn't want to say that because I never wanted to make that comparison where you're like, it's the this. You know what I mean?
I liked how, you know, they kept pushing the fact that, like, oh, is this thing a simulation? Is this that or whatever?
Yeah.
And then, like, how it ended.
If you rewatch it, then there's, like, there's a lot of
signs. Yeah, there are a lot of little clues.
Yeah.
I especially like the rock skipping element where she was just like.
It only skips. It skips four times every single time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of people being in simulations that didn't realize it this season.
Well, yeah, you guys mentioned that this is kind of like a happier episode.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's only happy if you think it's cool to imprison your sim in like a sim of yourself is like imprisoned in a dating app, basically.
I don't know. I never took it that way. I think that one was more like this is an aggregation of information about you, and it's represented as a sim in the show, not like our Star Trek episode.
I'm a little bit lost, but I'm actually kind of happy that you said this. So at the end of the spin the DJ or whatever, it wasn't like it's a simulation, like they just started over in a different time period, or was that actual reality?
No, that the last one that we, the final thing we see, what we see at the end is we see all like 1,000 variations of them pairing together, all gathered in the same place, and then they turn into their aggregated data, their information about the people. Then they all become like, I don't know, little, I guess, pips or whatever. Like, they all represent one cycle of a successful pairing. And that's what equals into the 99.8% or whatever it said at the end.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, but what I'm saying, though, at the end,
That was actually them.
That's real life.
That was them in a bar. Because the whole idea is that the sim is running the calculations in real time. And so to the sim, like, that time is elongated, so it seems like a series of days, but it's really just a matter of seconds, our time. So by the time they see each other in the bar, they're like, oh, shit, this says it'll work. That kind of thing. Like, that's,
Wow. Okay, I totally didn't get that. I was thinking, like, oh, shit, it just starts over. No. But, like, it's
That's what I was thinking. That's such a different implication. That's crazy. Like, if it was just like, man, do it again.
Because, like, you know how they say it's like, oh, we were meant to be together. Like, you know, like, all these things, like, you know, whatever. Yeah. So to me, it was just like, wow, it just starts over at this point because it's kind of like they don't know how they got there. They're just there.
Yeah, no,
They have to run through everything to kind of just keep doing this over. But, you know, that's how I thought about
You're definitely wrong.
Thanks.
I'm pretty sure it's kind of like that because, it's like, all the different versions of themselves, I think, are the whole, like, scenario playbook. As in, like, it's been played this many times that if this tries this, it ends up together. So it's like that's kind of how it worked out, but you were just wrong on the timing. Like, it wasn't at the ending for that.
They basically rebelled from the structure of the system.
The Truman Show,
you know, they did that 998 times out of 1,000. Yeah.
So it makes you think, I wonder if the idea is that they rose above everything else, which is why at the end they climbed this crazy huge ladder.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
no, but the way that you were explaining it, though, like, that didn't actually happen. It's just like that way that it's represented.
Yeah.
It's the way that the algorithm is represented in like a artistic sense.
Yeah.
I think it actually happened. Like, they actually, like, you know, set up the pieces on the board and ran the simulation. Like, in NBA 2K, like, you could just sim the rest of the game. Like, but that, there's actual players, like, they're playing it, you know?
So, oh, boy, I don't, that's a look, man, I don't like that.
No, it's a mind fuck, man. And it's definitely leads into that one with the first episode, the Callister one.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
Like, to me, that right there just made me really rethink killing motherfuckers in video games.
Yo, but would you? I gotta know, though. Would you, if you could, though, like, when anybody you ever met pissed you off, keep a digital version of them that you tortured?
Man, that sucks. That's too much work, though.
The tech that
I believe
that, I would say, like, out of all the Black Mirror episodes, the tech that, like, enables you to create a perfect replica of somebody digital form via their like DNA. That's like clearly the most unrealistic also, of all the tech introduced into this.
I don't know who they think they're fooling. I know a 3D printer when I see one. but no, and the thing about that episode was, man, I was thinking back on it, like, they straight up do that in like some Voyager, like at least one episode of Voyager.
Well, there's a lot of Star Trek.
No.
Homage.
No, well, yeah. There. Yeah, but no, I mean specifically, there is an episode where there is a character who drives another character nuts, and he recreates him in the holodeck and chokes that motherfucker to death. Like, he kills him because he can't keep his temper under control, and he doesn't want to murder him in real life.
You know what I will say? You know what will never happen to me ever? I will never get bested by code.
Oh, I don't know.
Like, a sentient code is not going to get me.
It's
not going to get me in real life.
That's to say that this real life is real. It's not a natural situation.
You say that now, you end up getting John Henry. There goes the steel driving man.
I don't know.
Like, so I mean, if you're forget, like an AI, like, I'm not saying that like an AI can't get me, like something physical, like, you know, it's in like a T-1000 or like
So you're not saying that you can't fight a robot.
No, I'm saying that like code in, you know, what I'm saying, like a line of code, like literally like some C++ floating around, like, no. It's not gonna get me.
Carlos trust. Versus Yo. HTML and Python, it's Carlos every time.
Oh my god.
Put money on it right now.
That's our chance.
It ain't getting me.
I mean,
well, let's put together that algorithm and let him fight it out. We'll see which one climbs the ladder.
How you know if that's what it is? You think it's just going to present itself like a line of code?
Nah.
You know?
It's going to fuck up your bank record.
Well, how did it get him?
Because they were not just digital versions. They were perfect carbon copies. Like, she went in there having a background in coding. She could still code. Like, it's not like they all went in and they just looked like people. No, she went in there with the same skill set that she had in real life.
I think it's like this. It's not just the whole DNA thing. I think the idea is that you have to imagine it like the computer that's replicating this person scans them from the point that they exist at. And then from that point, like, runs the simulation of every possible scenario this person could react in based upon their skill sets. Like, she already knew coding, so how would she react when placed in this situation? She'd be like, oh shit, I can hack this. Oh shit, I can do that. Like, it's kind of like that.
See, that's the one really shaky bit of, I mean, truly shaky bit of science in that episode was, like, they reused those, I don't know, the little things that they put on their temples. We know, based on the show, that they can copy entire, like, I don't know, sets of engrams from people and have all their memories and basically recreate them. What he was doing was something different and way creepier. Way creepier.
He was a starer.
He was a bit of a starer. But that's the thing. When that episode started, I was like ready for something to happen to make his life terrible enough that he went off the deep end. Like the Meow Meow Beans episode last season. Now that dude was
a monster from
Earth. He was a monster. I feel like he was made a monster by everybody shitting on him at work every day, but yeah, he was a monster. You think that he started doing that to people before?
I think the reason why everybody was a dick to him is because he was been that dude his whole life probably, and that's why he had no friends to begin with.
That sucks.
The guy got him the black dude got him the wrong latte. Like, yeah, remember when they're all listing off their reasons?
Skinny vanilla latte.
Yo, in real life, he was calling that dude, like, Ensign or some shit. Like, he was using his space fleet title.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. I just feel like that scenario started with, I'm getting everybody coffee, but not that guy. And, like, everybody just sits there talking shit about him and looking at him and knowing that he can see them and nobody cares. And I feel like that might have made things a little worse.
It's like, what came first, the asshole or the mass shooting?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
There was a lot of, like, Gamergate, like, menaced call-outs, I guess.
Yeah.
It's, on the bigger scale, though, is kind of, to me, it's like the whole representation of their digital copy themselves, them remembering, them trying to escape this plane of existence. Sure. Mm-hmm. It's crazy, like, that alone. It's like, it just kind of makes you really think, like, what is yourself? Like, what is your conscience? You know, like, what is that? Because
it's a bubble unit fueled by an asshole god.
It's a good
quote, right, man. So it kind of just makes you think, like, what is this all about? You know, like, our actual plane of existence, is that something else that's just crazy? Like, is there people just running around within the same thing? I think I'm losing myself.
Not really. You just kind of ended up going around and touching upon the simulation. Like, you didn't really lose yourself. Like, you made a point, because there's something like that that exists in our world. One of our most intelligent people believes we live in a simulation. So it's, like, not too far off at all.
Yeah. There's no way of telling if we do or don't.
Yeah.
Is the problem.
Yeah, exactly. And like the odds,
true, at this point.
And the odds of it, there's the, like, the, yeah, just like the chances of us being not a simulation is just so slim. It's like,
yeah,
we know that this isn't that, though, because we can all pull down our pants and there's genitalia.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but still, at the, I mean, end of, yeah, at the end, when they were in the actual game, they did that and they were like, oh yeah, I got a dick. Oh, I got,
I saw those two look at each other. Like, they were ready.
They're ready to bone.
You know, all I'm saying is I hope that at the end of all this, I wake up and end up with a really nice girlfriend.
Wait, what?
I mean, if it's all a simulation, I hope that this is my dating algorithm and it works out all right. That's all I'm saying.
That would be so shitty, though, because if you do live in a simulation, it's like all your fears, all your insecurities, all whatever, that's all coded by some ad, like some dick decided what you were going to hate and also decided on, like, the size of, you know, like your dick, your hands, your fingers, like everything.
I mean, but all that could be just random.
It could be a randomizer.
Yeah, it can be all, like, simulated.
The randomizer that they didn't have on the stone skipping code.
Yeah. Or, like, yes, you know,
they skipped over.
Like, on the other. Oh, my God. On the other end of it, though, it could be just as much the, you know, if it's, it could just be machine code, right? Like, so, like, we could just be a much more complicated thing that a person didn't write, so we're infinitely more complicated.
Now that you mention it, James, I do hope that this is actually your dating sim that we are in right now.
You're all in my dating sim.
I'm just like, now I'm sad, man. I think we all have girlfriends, too, except for...
James, do you have a girlfriend?
Not right now, guys.
See? This is his sim. All right, but one thing, though, that really I can't really wrap my finger around is, sure, we have the internet and everything's cool and everything. How the hell does he store digital copies of people on his fucking PC?
It's just code.
It's code, man. Compression.
It's just code. Yeah, they don't have to fit people. You don't have to fit people in there.
Yeah,
like physically.
There aren't people in a back room where he's.
No. I'm not saying he's physically fitting people, but I'm saying, yeah, it's still code, but it still takes up space. You know, coding takes up digital space. You know, it's still going to be like megabytes.
It's lean.
You know, gigabytes or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, my computer has 3 hard drives in it, and you're telling me they don't have the compress. They can, like, transfer consciousness into the internet, and they can't compress some shit down to like, a small file size?
I'm just saying.
Look, no, they can't.
I'm just saying, he's done this.
A personality is a lot of terabytes.
He's done this for a long time. Yeah.
I feel like we can look this up.
I mean, terabytes. How many terabytes is a human soul?
Bro, they got 8K TVs.
Yeah, they have 8K TVs. 8K.
8K TVs.
8K TVs.
Oh, man.
45.
You know what? I hope so, because then you never have to lose anybody. Just download you to, like, my TV and shit and just be like, okay, run Shane.exe.
But that's not me, though.
It is you, though.
It was you at some point, but you've grown since then. But
I've gotten a little bit taller.
It was you at one point when
I found the answer.
What? Okay, James. How much terabytes is a human consciousness?
All right, I'm going to read you a short paragraph. Most computational neuroscientists tend to estimate human storage capacity somewhere between 10 terabytes and 100 terabytes, though the full spectrum of guesses ranges from 1 terabyte to 2.5 petabytes.
Ooh, that's a lot. Yeah.
That's Is that the human storage capacity, as in like that's the capacity our brains can store?
Yeah.
Well, that's different than like your mannerisms, your characteristics, your thoughts.
Yeah, I'm aware of that. I'm just saying we have the hardware and we can, or is it wetware? What would you even call it?
Yeah, it would be wetware.
So we have the wetware. We know what it's capable of storing. So that's, you know, that's helpful, I guess.
It's a baseline. We can work from there. We need to get that Piper compression software.
Other than that, we know that from the Black Museum that, you know, we don't utilize all of that space.
Did anybody else cringe at that when they were like, you're not using like 60% of your brain?
Yeah, I know. It's kind of a crazy thing, but, you know, let's just kind of say for shits and giggles, it kind of is that way.
I don't mean to jump ahead, but the museum episode, I have a lot of questions about the end of it.
We can jump ahead.
Normally you would say, okay, so this is sort of how it went. But like the end of that episode was just like, okay, wait a second. So you were able to like, okay, so what did you do? Did you go to school planning revenge? Like, you went through a full college education to learn how to hack a system, like, so you could get back at the dude who ruined your dad's life after prison ruined it? Anyway, the point I'm getting at is she managed to copy that dude onto her dad's memory.
She copied a program onto a program, right?
Right, right. And not only that, but she also had her mother in her head using a technique that was only used, as far as we know, on a prototype because it failed.
No, they actually proved, they said that they did it, but then it was like one of those things that, like, let's say the FDA came through and they're just kind of like, well, it's kind of a fucked up practice to do that because people were putting them, like, people's minds into teddy bears and all that type of bullshit. So it's kind of like the person's alive.
I'm pretty sure that you're like kind of supposed to fill in the blanks, much like animation. It's kind of like they keyframed it out, but you got to put the tweens there yourself, in the terms that, like, you got to figure she was just a tech genius.
I don't think she was like, I think you're going too far into it. I think the procedure was allowed back then, you know, and then they just kind of stopped doing it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, I get that the technology evolved and became the cloud for old people.
Right.
I'm just like, girl, why did you just have that shit around your house? How did you...
I don't think she had it around her house. I think she just, you know, for sake of storage, she got it. She got it in,
I guess,
before...
There's a lot of leap of faith that you have to take with this. Not just that episode. There was a lot of episodes in this season where you kind of... Like, even, like, in USS Callister, like, when they're trying to explain the DNA sequence, the DNA...
Did they even
like,
try
they're just
to explain
like,
it?
They, like, somebody tried, and then they were like, yeah, don't worry about it. Like,
yeah, we're here.
Because Black Mirror, duh. Like, never mind.
Which is fine. We were trying to explore greater themes.
I'm sorry.
Let's take a pause.
All right. Oh, okay. Yeah, we got to... Why save are we pausing? It because we want to make sure that we have the audio saved. All right. Because
I just wanted to say I would never put my mom in my fucking head.
Right? Right?
We were talking about Aziz. And the latest article on babe.net.
Babe. Speaking of which, have you guys read that article?
I read it.
Nope. I didn't read it. I heard it.
I have confusing feelings about that.
Shane said those days of wild dick slinging are over.
The Wild Wild West days of dick slinging
are foregone.
Are coming to an end.
You might get an article written about you.
Yep.
Wait a minute. Aziz Ansari has claims?
You didn't hear about this?
Oh, where have I been? Where the fuck have I been?
All right.
No. This is perfect because he's got books like Modern Love and shit, and he like talks about creepy dudes in his stand-up special, but he is a creepy dude. Oh, it's perfect.
It's not like that.
He's not a creepy dude. He's
a moderately creepy dude.
I won't say like
no. Yo, no, we're no. in a debate now. We're in a debate over how creepy he is. I have to find out more about this. Please educate me.
No, well, what happened is that, you know, he went on a date with this lady and, you know, they were getting a little bit hot and heavy in the kitchen. And Aziz was pushing for a certain thing. And then she was like, I'm not comfortable with this. Pretty much, you know, Aziz acknowledges that, puts on clothes, goes on the couch, and just kind of calls it at night, you know, whatever.
But he didn't.
Here's what happened, because what you're telling is sort of a shortened version of it.
Yeah.
I mean, which is fine, but essentially what happened was they had dinner, they went back to Aziz's place, and yeah, he pushed for it, and like they
not
had wine
like,
or whatever.
Really like crazy. Like,
not he's crazy. Like, he was just like, "Hey, can you know
the room?"
Yeah, he basically was like, literally. "Okay, we're
making
out." Trying
to push her hand down into his pants.
Yeah. He put his hand on her breast and he kissed her a lot. And yeah, something I don't know about that. Was there a bit about
one,
him putting
at
his,
a certain
putting
point? She says to him, "I don't feel comfortable."
Yeah, the point is she said, according to the article, she was like, "Nonverbal communication," and he didn't seem to notice. And then eventually she said something and he was like, oh, okay, cool. And they stopped.
No, he said something like,
I'm Randy.
I'm Randy works in that situation too because it's a double entendre.
Yeah. No, he said, I mean, basically he said that, but no, he was like, oh no, baby girl, it's only fun if we're both having a good time. When I read that, I can only hear it in his voice though.
Yeah, no, I get it. But no, because what happened was she was like, I'm uncomfortable, and he was like, oh, okay, let's stop. But then they just kind of hung around naked for a little while, and he tried again, and she was still like, nah, though. Because like they were like, okay, well, let's go sit on the couch, and they did this naked apparently, and then I guess he tried to push forward again, something like, oh, she said, basically, she was like, oh, you know, not on the first date. And he was like, oh, if I give you a glass of wine, is that the second date? Can that be the second date? And then that didn't work out. And then they hung out for a while. And then she got up and was like, I'm going to go. And she left and cried all the way home. And then sent him a text the next day like, hey, I was really upset. That was a terrible experience. Worst date of my life. And he was like, oh, shit, I didn't know you weren't having a good time. And the thing is she did this anonymously and did this article for Babe. And like she's like a 23-year-old photographer, if I remember correctly.
She yeah, is. What says. But yeah. The article says
good for her.
It was good for her. But it was just like she's like that was the worst night of my life, and I was like, look, I mean, I understand where you're coming from, but like
can I give my counter argument?
Hold on. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. So
what do you guys say?
I've never heard this in my entire life being like intimate with a girl. I've never heard. I don't feel comfortable right now.
Because Carlos is a fucking
with
player.
A lot of girls.
All right.
I've never heard those words ever. First of all.
Carlos never
just like, yeah. First of all, we want you to know that Carlos has a pretty good record, all right? Like, Carlos has been, he knows about the days of wild dick slinging. This is why he's retired now.
That's not what I mean. But here's the thing. If I ever did hear that, like, at no point will I think, in the back of my head, will I think, how can I finesse this into penetration?
Really?
Really?
You're not always
I don't feel comfortable right now. If like a girl looks at me and is like, I don't feel comfortable right now, I'm just like, all right, well, this is a wash. That's a bad sign. That's like, that's like, it's over, bro. Like,
yeah.
But I mean, it's one of those things though, like, and it's kind of a touchy thing because we weren't there to actually hear like how the tone she was saying it or whatever. And well, I only bring this up because
the tone of the article was bad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because you don't really get like too much of what's actually.
It wasn't like it definitely wasn't like the New York Times. It was poorly edited.
I still want to stay here that it's kind of sad that this type of article, as much as it's been a piece to gather attention, you know, probably to disrupt, you know, either the movement that's happening or, you know, for even Aziz's like career, if anything, it's such a stupid piece because it doesn't really help anything. And I disagree. No, because it goes away because it looks like, look, this is how it's kind of in some sense is taken. It's like there, I mean, I have to say that I don't think that the night was horrible.
it was a bad date.
Yeah.
It's easy for you to say.
Well, listen, I'm saying it's like, it's not like Aziz.
It wasn't you that was that had a lifter.
Well, hear me out before you make your judgment. I'm saying on how this piece comes out to the public and how they're comparing Aziz's date to, you know, people like Harvey Weinstein, who these guys who literally have gone into dates, bring back women to their house, take out their dicks.
Nobody's comparing this situation to that situation.
But it's one of those things that it happened around this time. So you get what I'm saying? You see how things get tossed away, like the seriousness of, like, you know, a Harvey Weinstein case or such like that. It gets tossed away when something like this whole incident with Aziz happens, and then it's just kind of like, whoa, you read the headlines and you're like, whoa, Aziz is like a sex predator, like he's all this, but then you really read it out, and you're just kind of like,
yeah,
you're just kind of like,
hashtag time's up.
It's really miscommunication, and at the end of the day, I think we've all been in a situation where we've read the room wrong.
Yeah, I'd say so.
You know?
I mean, yeah. Like, even reading this, I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off, but like, I'm like reading through it, and yeah, I do get the impression that he was really pushy, but if she'd have been like, just straight up no, it would have been done. Not to say that it's her fault for not doing that, I'm just saying that he didn't seem like he was trying to do anything but get laid, right? Like, he wasn't trying to be like, you don't want it, I'm taking it anyway. It wasn't like that.
Well, yeah, I don't think anybody's making that argument, though.
Yeah.
So I think that there's a valid case here about just coercion in general. Like, that's really something that not a lot of people talk about. And one good thing about this article, I think, is that now people are talking about that. Like, that's something, too. Like, it's not rape, but it's something. And
yeah, it's not nothing.
It's fucked up.
It's not nothing.
It's not nothing. Yeah, like, it's definitely, like, you're trying to, you know, coerce somebody into sleeping with you. It's pretty unchill.
What?
And no, and I'm glad that you said that.
Okay, wait. No, I really need to talk about this. All right.
No, go like, for it. No, because I'm happy that you brought up the what, Gavin. What are you going to say?
Like, that's fucked up because whenever one of us, all right, a straight male is trying to get with a girl, every time I've been trying to coerce her into sleeping with me, all right? I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Like, how the fuck do you think I got in there? Like I had to convince her. Like, it
wasn't.
Were
you not trying to be her friend?
Nigga.
Gavin's still on that Wild West dick slang.
There's a difference between like peacocking, which is what I do.
He's saving himself so well.
Did you just pull a straight up? That sounds like it's out of a manual.
Yeah, well, you never heard of peacocking?
Oh, I've heard of it. I've heard of it. I've just never heard anybody be like, oh yeah, peacocking, that's what I'm about.
No, here's some honest truth though. Like, there are specific strategies and certain ways in which you might maneuver within a social situation in order to attain a desired object. This desired object may happen to be a woman. I'm not trying to objectify women. I'm just saying.
When you call it an object.
No, I get what you're saying. I'm just saying.
No, when you break it down, like, you're turning your desire into kind of like
an objective.
An objective, a mission. You know what I mean? It's not that I'm walking into a situation being like, oh, well, I don't give a fuck about women and their feelings. I'm just going to try to fuck every girl in here. But if I see a girl that catches my interest, I am trying to figure out an appropriate way or an appropriate angle from which to approach her, because that's just honestly the mechanics of human dating. There's a certain line that's being crossed here where there's like too much control and too many people like trying to dial back on what it is between a man and a woman to actually try and get together. Some of dating is just really fucking weird and it's really fucking awkward and it has to be that way.
It doesn't.
Well, I mean, it doesn't have to be that way.
Okay, I'll continue.
It's always been that way just because you feel some type of way about it, but you know, if we can talk about it and open up a dialogue, then maybe it doesn't have to be that way. Maybe people can just not have like get hurt over it.
Okay, but the thing is, that's what comes with putting yourself out there within any given situation, whether it's trying to date, whether it's simply making friends, whether it's joining a group, a band, whatever. There's a certain level of you could get hurt from this. And I think that dating has to remain strange and awkward because we're not like telepathic. And everybody knows that to come right out and be like, hi, you're really cute, and I'm trying to figure out how to get into your vagina does not work. All right. Like that.
Listen.
You got to be on a certain level of game to pull that line off. All right. But you can't just be rolling up and saying that off the cuff. If you're a guy who, like, let's say you just started dating, like, there's no way you're going to pull that line out because you're already nervous as hell. You're already trying to figure out, like, you know, what kind of girls are into me? Like, what kind of girls do I actually want to talk to? And all these nonverbal cues that she's talking about, like, these things are very much a huge part of the intricacy of dating.
Yeah.
I think the bottom line is if you're a guy, you got to turn your fucking sensitivity meter way the fuck up. You got to be in tune with nonverbal communication. If it's not fucking a sure thing, then you really got to like chill the fuck out.
Okay.
And true. Maybe it wasn't your night. Maybe, you know, you got to run it back again. Run that play back again.
True.
Next time, you know, and that way. Everybody's safe. Everybody doesn't feel some type of way about it. Nobody gets tight.
I'm still like reading over this, man.
You don't get articles written about you.
That's what you got to do. You got to stand away from those articles. Yeah. So but, I mean, like I agree with you, Gavin and Carlos. You know, like this is a very, and also you too, James.
Hi.
This is a very difficult subject, but I think, you know, it's one of those things that. It's a good time that this stuff is happening because, you know, like everything, it's a good conversation. We're talking about things that we would look over. But I think once it's settled, we have to really come on a happy medium. I mean, it's crazy because I know there's like some, you know, consensual like apps out there. So it's kind of like before you even do anything, it's like you sign off your consent. Are we going to get to that point where, you know, I mean, we did see that in that Black Mirror episode. You know, they one of the first things that they did was like consent to have sex. You know, and
you know,
pretty much everyone that we've seen already hit yes to do it. You mean so? Imagine you could not have done it.
You have to consent to like see your expiry date.
Yeah, dating is a weird thing. It's good that we're having this because we need to hear the voice from the opposite side. And you know, the only way that we're really gonna take it to heart is if we actually really listen. And even though like I kind of agree that stories like this, you know, isn't something that we really need to spend a lot of attention on, but it makes a big ringer. But yeah, I kind of think it's not that big, but yes, it is still a big deal because it's a little things that matter that get into bigger things, you know, because today, you know, it's like the girls like doing nonverbal stuff and saying like no, but then the guy's still persisting, you know, versus the guy just straight up pulling his dick out and start jerking off on the girl, you know. It's Lewis like CK. We're not there yet.
Shout out to Lewis.
So
okay,
damn, so, he's canceled, man. That sucks. Dude,
I went back and I was rereading some of this and honestly from her perspective seems pretty bad, and he was just like trying to do some work, you know what I mean? But like yeah turns out I kind of had some of the events out of order, but all in all, yeah, she just wasn't into it and was not clear about it, and he was not paying attention, so he should have been paying more attention and she should have been clearer, and it's all bad.
That happens more often than you think though, and that happens just on every regular date where it's like, you know, maybe people tried to get together but it ended up weird. That's how people end up with awkward sexual experiences, and those experiences help you grow and see what you actually want out of a relationship.
It's the algorithm.
Yeah. Oh shit.
Yeah, for real.
This is my dating sim.
That's how it used to work. It wasn't digital. You just went out, you dated someone. Maybe it was awkward when she tried to suck your dick. Maybe it was fucking awkward when you tried to like touch her. Like it just didn't work out. And then you left and you knew better. That's it. Like, and that's how it had to be a little.
She should have beat him over the head with an iPad like the daughter
bringing
from
it back.
Archangel.
From Archangel.
Yo. Yo, Archangel. Thank you. We needed to go back.
No, man. And one thing that pissed me off about Archangel.
That shit was like, okay, I get it. She beat her in the head with with like the physical device. All right, I get it.
It's a great scene. It's a great scene.
It's a I understand this analogy.
My one thing about that is like, hey, if I'm gonna like, I know that this thing can mess with how I perceive things. I'm gonna turn it off before I beat her over the head with it. Like, just hold down the power button. You grew up with the internet. I know you did, because you live in Black Mirror world.
Nah, man. She was in a fit of rage, and she just started whooping her mom's ass.
You know what's interesting is that the same technology that they used to kind of blur out negative images, like the dog barking or yeah, whatever was turned on, that's the same technology in the one episode, yeah, where the soldiers are shooting like that. Yeah. So you know about that.
Mm-hmm. I'm just like, my thing is like, I'm like, hey, Mom, you're kind of a dumbass. You know that, like, not exposing your kid to anything is going to ruin them, right? Like, that just, I get being a scared parent, but that just seems so over the top as a reaction to me. Like, I know there are people out there like,
scared parent.
Yeah, I mean, I get that. And it seems like parents are becoming more afraid as time goes on.
Yeah. I mean, you got to wait a certain amount of years before you show your kid audition. That's,
yeah.
Yeah.
That's
I mean, but it's one of those things though that, like, to me, that I like the episode, but it kind of just tells you one thing, man. People don't watch everything. They only watch in 5 seconds, or they read the header and they take that for the whole, you yeah know, for the whole gist of it. If she had watched her daughter have sex, it's or weird, her daughter do the drugs, she would have been like, oh, the guy didn't really pressure her into it. She's not talking that way. Like the guy was like an okay guy. The guy was like telling her like, hey, you don't have to tell me like fuck you harder. Like, you don't have to mimic porn. Yo, I don't want you to do these drugs. I'm selling them. I don't do them. Please don't do them. But then she was like, yo, I want to try it, you know? But no, her mom just saw like, oh, fuck me harder. And like taking like a rail of coke, and like she went off the rails and she was like, oh my God, where's my baby?
She took a few rails.
Well,
oh my God, no.
Speaking of, I'm pretty sure I'm the only parent here.
As far as I know.
Allegedly.
Allegedly, yeah.
Only one that anyone, yeah, the only one with any clue.
No, I actually have, Sayan has on his phone, he has a Find My Friend on his phone. So,
Find My Phone now?
No, Find My Friend, I think.
Yeah, it's Find My Friend, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So how it's like, it's, work? Well, I can go on my phone and I can see where he's at, like location.
Oh, wow.
I can't see what he sees. I can't block him from seeing things.
Right.
But you know what? He knows that's there. It's not like a secret or something.
I mean, that's like the. I mean, this is like where it starts from, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I think
I kind of go the opposite with him, you know, because I don't really shield him from any kind of scary ideas or scary visuals. If anything, I try to expose him to as much fucked up shit as possible.
Gotta let him see the world for what it really is.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
Can I read something from a previous subject though? Like, I I've been going through this article, and, like, I didn't know about it until tonight, but, I just wanted to read. She says, Ansari began making a move on her that he repeated during their encounter. The move he was doing was taking his two fingers in a V shape and putting them in my mouth, in my throat, to wet his fingers. What the because fuck? The moment he'd stick his fingers in my throat, he'd go for my vagina and try to finger me. Grace called the move the claw. Nigga, what the fuck?
What?
Yo, I did not remember. You don't got that in your playbook, bro?
Oh, no.
You guys need to level up. Fuck that, man. That's fucking...
All right, Aziz, you officially... Like, before, I was going to give you a pass, but bro...
Like, I never even thought to do that. I mean, why in her throat? And then... At the same time,
wouldn't like that gag you? Like,
I would think so.
Yeah. Yeah, it would be like real. It would get like weird immediately. Yeah. Like,
yo, that's a bad algorithm. Yeah. That is a bad match.
It's a bad match. Bad. For sure.
Yeah.
Do we need to talk about any of these other episodes?
We do. Like, let's keep going.
I mean, we can.
I just had to cut back. Like, that just. So I just read that and I had to share.
overall, what did you guys think about this season? Was it like
good? Like I think what they really did that I liked was it seemed like a callback to past season. You know, like how they've mentioned in Black Museum, like, oh, the technology wasn't as cool as how it is how they upload old people to the cloud.
Well, yeah, I think it's pretty properly established now that all of these stories take place in the same universe.
That's what I thought. I feel like some of them can't. Unless they're just way further down the timeline.
I think that's it.
That's what it is, yeah.
Fucking with the time, yeah.
Mm-hmm. One thing I wanted to say is that if for anything, one of the coolest devices that was made was that whole thing where the guy could feel other people's
orgasms.
Oh boy. Yeah. Hey, no, Faye.
That would legitimately be the best part.
I mean, he could feel other people's orgasms.
The simultaneous male female orgasm.
He really sold that scene.
Yeah.
Can I tell you though, Black Mirror honestly has some of the greatest supervillain origin stories ever. Like, because that's just straight up, like, that guy, like, you put a couple $1 million behind that, that's a supervillain movie.
Yeah. Most every episode can easily be, like, its own feature film.
Yeah. I liked Metalhead. That one terrified me.
Metalhead was good.
Metalhead could have easily been, like, a feature-length movie.
Yeah.
That robot could do anything. It drove after her. It put a truck in her.
It cannot do everything. It was easily bested by a can of paint.
Let's remake Terminator with that robot. That's what I want.
Oh, shit. Fuck that.
I mean, all you really need is a can of spray paint, and it's a wrap.
Not really.
Gang of Uncommon.
But that was just one.
Yeah.
Chill. Imagine that shit in a pack.
Yeah, I mean, like, the scenario of escaping those things is not good, especially if it blasts you in the face with a bunch of trackers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well,
she was kind of dumb, though. I feel like
he was very dumb.
That you get far away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody in that episode did, like, 7 dumb things.
Yeah.
The dude that was driving the van, and, like, the dog, like, jumps into the back of the van, and he just keeps driving, like, everything is peachy. Like, do something. An evasive maneuver. You know, like, suddenly slammed the brakes. Something. He didn't do anything. The thing has a gun on its hand.
So, speaking of
45.
Just the way that thing worked, that thing, it ran out of battery life, right?
At one point.
No, it was solar powered.
Well, no, because, like, I feel like she kept waking it up to drain the battery.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And
then she was like, let me not bury this. Like, I feel like step one is, okay, it's not moving when it gets hit anymore. I'm going to put that thing underground. Like, I feel like you would know that you don't want light hitting it.
Yeah. She could have very easily survived this encounter.
Yeah.
With very minor adjustments.
First of all, teddy bears are not that important. Fucking make one. I'm sure there's some burlap somewhere around there. Like, just make a teddy bear.
Not that important.
Because that was the thing. They were like, we have to get the replacement. And the replacement was a teddy bear. And I'm just like,
you didn't know it was the teddy bear was stuffed with.
No, though. we didn't know. Yeah, it could have been stuffed with, I don't know. Like, the thing is, black tar, like, heroin. Yeah, I was going to say cocaine. They're all chasing the dragon.
I mean, there was no reason. Like, once she got it, like, once she outsmarted it enough where it was just like drilling into like the side of a speaker for like 7 minutes, you beat it. You beat that thing. Like, look at it now. It's like trying to drill into the side of a speaker on the side of a car door. Like, you just all at that point, you just have to like walk away and you won.
That's true.
Yeah. And then she decided that, like, no, I'm going to try to blast it.
Oh, you mean like when she got the paint on it, she should have just ditched?
Yeah.
She could have just ditched.
It's like, peace. Yeah. It's like, bye.
Bye.
But you know what? I think the thing is that they really didn't know anything of those machines.
I mean, it's just like it's drilling into like the side of a car door and it's not paying any attention to you. I think at that point you can very clearly see that, like, oh, this thing's dumb as fuck. I'm out of here.
How about some real fucking armor? How about just like anything that stops small pieces of metal that aren't flying terribly
fast? That's what I'm saying.
They didn't have like, I would have been like, definitely if I'm out in that world, I would have had some at least at minimum some like motocross.
Yeah, look at anything.
Some shin guards.
Yeah, if you're in that kind of post-apocalyptic environment, biker gear should be your life from then on. Yeah. Like,
I mean, there's the only
no
thing
reason
is,
to wear anything else.
The only thing that I'm really against your guys' theories is because they didn't give us enough backstory.
That's true.
To understand where they're at. You know, because it could have been like one of those things, like it just happened and these people are banding together or, you know, or whatever.
You can tell that this episode was written 2 years ago because Boston Dynamics straight up has robots that are on two legs now. That's a thing.
Yeah.
They do backflips. I've seen it.
But wait, have you seen the new version of the dog?
Yes, and it looks scary as fuck.
The yellow and black one or whatever, it looks exactly like
I don't like how sleek they're getting.
You know what I don't like? I don't like that right now, as we're talking, there is like one of those guys like the USS Callister guy, like that character. Like there's one in real life that is just bullying the shit out of one of those Boston Dynamic dogs.
Yeah.
Just because he can.
Yep.
When you say like the Callister guy, are you talking about the dude at the end who was the fucking king of space?
Oh, Jesse Pinkman. Yeah. No, that was kind of the kick in the balls. We're like, oh yeah, they escaped this prison and then now you just get to live in this wasteland that is online games.
I don't think it's the wasteland though.
I thought that was awesome.
The best part of the episode. I was like, fuck yeah, I would do that. Immortal in a spaceship in a procedural universe.
But you also have to live there with all of like the worst people in reality.
So start a fucking guild.
I don't think they're immortal.
But you play online games.
Yeah, I'm not excluding myself. I'm not excluding myself from the pool.
Like,
I'm not a toxic online gamer. I think the moral of the story actually for that, and probably this whole entire season of Black Mirror was
don't be a creep.
No, keep your nudes on the cloud.
No, don't keep.
Wasn't the nudes? That's how they got them.
Yeah, that's how they got them.
But you know what? That's really crazy that she went through all of that to stop these nudes from happening.
Because she knows herself. She's like, what's the one thing that I would be terrified of ever happening, even though I did it? And then, you know, she knew herself, and that's how she got herself to sneak into the home.
So the thing is, that's really even crazy to bring it back to that, is like, what did he do? Sure, at the end of the day, he digitized and he made, you know, versions of these people that he can control and make fucked up scenarios and have them play out things.
Mm-hmm. Torture.
Is there morals? Is there something immoral about that?
Yes.
You mean the fact that he's torturing sentient beings because they're straight up clones of real people?
But are they? But they're AI.
I don't think they are. I think the implication here is that they are.
They have fear. They have fear, which is like the most human of all emotions.
Yeah, but they can't die.
Not dying is like a worse torture than.
Right, but they're not part of the real world.
But that's theoretical. What is the real world?
But exactly. So then, like, to me, it's like one of those things.
We're not part of the real world. If they're not part of the real world, we're not part of the real world.
Well, yeah, but then this, like, you know, this brings into the crazier thought processes. Like,
so you're cool with, like, if I had a Boston Dynamics dog and I'm just, like, kicking it, torturing it all seven different types of ways.
Forcing it to fight other robot dogs?
Yeah, like, that would be cool. Like, you'd be, like, you don't think that that's like...
It's a robot dog, right? Have you guys programmed emotions into it? Because if it's just a robot dog...
It whimpers. It gets scared.
If it's programmed to emote, then that's some sociopathic shit you're doing.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Like, that's abuse. That's being like, I really want to abuse this inanimate object, but I want the satisfaction of listening to it suffer. That's fucked up. But
yeah, because
like, if it was just like programmed to just like walk back and forth and I watched you like kick it around and shit, that's hilarious. That's just funny.
But you see, I guess because overall to me, it seems like it opens up that bigger question. It's like, what do we consider real? Okay. What do we, you know, like at what point?
If it has feelings, bro, it's like it's real.
Well, what I want to say is that it's a copy. It's so what's so different from that one character that you're playing in Grand Theft Auto and you're like, the person's like, no, please don't kill me. And you just, because
that's a recorded piece of dialogue that It is programmed to say in a certain scenario in the game, it is not a carbon copy of a human being that you uploaded to your computer. It's not the same thing.
That's like saying like the Aziz situation was the same as Weinstein.
Well, okay. When I found out about the claw, it was kind of weird. But can we take a brief moment to talk about each one of these? I'd like to talk about each one of these situations. I would like to say Harvey Weinstein, after looking at his face, I totally understand why that man achieved that much power and fame and notoriety so that he could do that to women. That's like specifically that was his shit. Matt Lowry was a fucking predator. Louis C.K., I feel like that was the kindest form of making a woman uncomfortable that like could have possibly happened. Like, no, listen, listen. Have you thought about how like this is possibly have you thought about how this is possibly Louis C.K.'s greatest joke ever? Like, all he did was make these women uncomfortable. They could have left at any point in time, but you stood there as a man who looks like Louis C.K., stripped completely naked, sat down, spread his legs, and then started to play with his dick, and the whole time, beat for beat, you just stood there like, all right, so this is happening.
As dark humor as that is, and I love you for that.
Sorry.
It's still fucked up. And yeah, I'm happy that, you know, you put that spin on that.
Any boss I've ever had, if they were like, yo, Gavin, come into the back room, and like that happened beat for beat, like I wouldn't be there past... Oh, yeah, and then he started to unbuckle his belt. But, like, I didn't stay to find out where it was going.
Once again, as I said, we live in that that society that's very male-driven. So when you say these type of things, you're like, oh, yeah, I'll never do this because, you know, it's... But that's how the world is catered to you.
He literally he pulled his dick out and started jerking off at the people. See? Like, even if I didn't, like, get that offended by it, like, yo, you did that, homie. Like, you just pulled your dick out and started jerking off. Like, it's mad weird. It's a weird thing to do.
It's weird. And I mean...
I probably don't want to support you for that.
Yeah. You don't want to be around it.
I definitely don't want to be around it.
I get what you're saying, Gavin, because you're saying the implications of this guy like just jerking off on himself. You know, he's inflicting it onto himself. But I mean, it's like, it's really tough, man, because
there's also a power dynamic involved.
Exactly. That that doesn't ever really affect you, you know, unless it's like race in your case, because you're a black male.
Mm-hmm. I literally had a white girl last year yell at me and point her finger in my face and tell me I would never understand what it was like to be put upon and mistreated because I will never be a woman. Boy. I'll never understand, all right? Like, I don't believe or co-sign a lot of the narrative out there today. She's
obviously an idiot, but that's
You can't take all the apples.
Look, I'm saying it's a little different, right? To be like, yo, he offered me a coffee and then I just fucking woke up and I was naked and he was next to me.
I mean,
all right? I watched this dude from a distance of about 5 feet get naked, pull out his dick and play with himself. And like, you didn't have to stay the whole time. You can say it's a power dynamic. You can say it's like whatever.
Even if she left immediately, like that's still a violation, man.
Look, I know, but dudes violate dudes, man. Guys do weird shit. Like, that's not the weirdest shit I've ever heard of a man doing. And like, to a certain extent, I don't feel like it's
not the weirdest. I watched an episode of a dude that was drilling a drill into somebody's head and like orgasm. I'm not saying that's the same thing as that. Those are two different things.
Okay, but I also
they're both like not... I can say that like I don't agree with either of them.
Yeah, trust. I mean, I see where you're coming from, but it's one of those things that like to bring back to that guy in Black Mirror, reason why he started off inflicting pain on himself, but he never got the full rush like of death because you know you can't scare yourself, so you need that fear.
And also probably in the same way, like that guy, like he's probably also getting off on the fact that he's like violating this woman, like you know, like it's making him like feel good about himself.
Yeah, because I mean, like, as you said, Gavin, if you were in that situation, some dude's jerking off in front of you, you'd be like, yo, what the fuck? And you would leave.
It's happened in the subway.
Well,
yeah. Last year, nigga, that shit happened in the subway. I was just like, oh, that guy's jerking his dick. I guess I gotta catch the cue. Like, all right.
Yeah, but like, you know,
It's not the same.
It's not the same.
Also, I will say
it's really hard for us to relate.
In Louis C.K.'s defense, like reading some of the articles about it, there was one woman that like he asked her. That's another thing that also bothers me. Like he asks all these people ahead of time.
I mean, you can like he talks about it in his stand-up all the time.
And one of those women,
you can make an argument that like, well, if you ever have a meeting with Louis C.K., like, you just take the risk of...
Look, man, if I had a meeting with Gallagher, I'd expect him to smash a watermelon.
You may be exposed to some genitalia.
I'm just thinking about the logic of that. Like, if I were a comedian, and I were gonna, like, if I were a comedian and how I got my jollies was I was like, I really want to jerk off in front of this girl. And then I, like, offered it, would she not take that as a comedic moment on my part? Like, I feel like, oh, he's 100% making a joke. This comedian that I'm talking to is making a joke about jerking off with me in a room with him. Fuck. Oh my god, this wasn't a joke. Like,
no, he's doing it.
It's meta.
That's literally
what it is. Oh no, it's meta.
Yep.
It's poor form.
Yeah.
I was going to say that there's one lady that says to him, though, she says, don't you have a wife and two daughters? And he's like, yeah, I'm fucked up. And he walks away.
I'm guessing a lot of the issue was that this is a male-driven industry, and she was trying to get started in this line of work. And he is comedy, like, royalty. And, you know, he's the comic that other comics like to say that they're into. So I don't want to offend this person because I don't want to be blackballed by every comedy show in town.
But doesn't that also mean that on some level she emotionally targeted him as a means to an end for her?
No, well, the thing is, bro, come on. You can't look at that because, I mean, realistically, you know who, when you go into a place, right, and you're trying to get to the top, and this is even what you even said, you know, with women and stuff like that. Like, you know, there's a certain game that you play along to get your goals.
Social politics, so, got you.
You know, so it's just one of those things that it's a fucked up game that we play, you know? And I think the only thing that really is going to help us is definitely the change of power. Hopefully we don't see more incidents like this happen when, you know, the balance of power has kind of...
It's over,
you know? Like, when the balance of power is, like, you know, balanced itself out. Anyway, yo, this episode's been really real, guys. Like,
it got real. It got real. We kind of went in a way. We went in a place, but I think it was a good place. And I think that it's important that we keep these type of conversations out there.
Yeah.
Keep the lines of communication open.
Lines open. And the more we talk about it, the more that shit does not get normalized.
Yeah. We definitely don't need it to be normal.
Can I just say consensual sex is the shit? Like, when a girl is actually like, hey, you, specifically you, I want you in this, like, it's fucking amazing. So if you're out there trying to fuck, always aim for consensual sex. It's like, really, it's the bee's knees.
Yep.
It's the only way to go, really.
Yeah.
It's a legitimate rape.
Yeah, otherwise you're breaking the law and also making everybody that knows you grosser.
Though I have heard a theory, and I've heard this theory.
No,
that,
stop.
Like...
I don't want to hear it. Shut up.
Hey, I mean, it's like they want to be rigged, but they don't want to be rigged, but it's by like a friend.
Gavin, bro. It was a pleasure having you on the show. James, it was awesome having you on the show. Good, like, Carlos, you know, it's fun to have all you guys here. And, you know, it's good for us to be actually, you know, getting back into the swing of things.
For sure. We're going to talk about our Patreon.
Oh, sweet.
If you guys start a Patreon, are you guys the only ones getting paid from it?
Yeah, am I going to get some of that sweet Patreon cheddar?
I mean, is that how this works? Are we independent contractors?
You're an artist.
You're an artist. You know how it goes.
You know about Patreon. I donated to Gavin.
Hey, we've all donated to each other. This is a circle, man. It's cool.
Circle jerk.
Circle jerk of creativity.
Yeah, yes. But you got to eat that cookie.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man. Nah. Not nah, us first. I ain't trying to eat the cookie.
You guys
want a creative cookie? You're not trying to eat someone's creative cookie?
I'm not trying to get that, dude. Circle jerk, and I'm over here trying to make rhymes like the circle of strife, but you're like, nah, circle jerk on this cookie. What the fuck, guys? That's
a creative cookie. I just wanted to tell everybody about our Patreon. It's a brand new deal.
Yep.
Like, we ain't trying to get, like, Aziz money with this.
We're just trying to take care of our monthly maintenance stuff, you know? It's not really expensive. If you go on the Patreon, I think it's like it's only like $50 that we have our goal to.
What's the exclusive content?
At this time, we're still working on it. We're making it simple, you know? We're just trying to cover
$1, $3, $5, whatever, you know.
Depending on how it rolls out, if it becomes something that definitely we take care
Shane
of our
wanted money. To add like the baller, the BBB, the big baller brand tier.
$1 million.
Yeah, but you get everything at that point.
You get to fly out to wherever we're at and, you know, do a live show with us. We make t-shirts with your face on it. Whatever you want, you know, you drop that one M.
We'll record a live show from Antarctica with some like live penguins.
With penguins.
That'll be
hell yeah.
You really shouldn't put shit like that out there. Do not say shit like that on the internet. Don't make it happen. Your ass will be cold, nigga. Like, you could end up real cold.
Yeah. So, anyway. Yeah. But, so back to reality. The thing is that, yeah, we're just trying to take care of some monthly maintenance stuff.
If you go on to patreon.com/theartschoolrejects,
yeah,
it'll be your bestest friends.
Also, we're working our way towards designing an Art School Rejects bomber jacket. That's actually not true, but I just wanted to say it.
Hey, it might happen.
Stickers, buttons, and posters coming soon. And a bomber jacket, but, you know, not right now.
What else, Gavin?
Just special for
our subscribers.
If our special raffle goes large enough and the Patreon does really well, we might also purchase one live tiger and put him inside one Maserati. Come out and see the Art School Rejects doing it big.
I like it. All right. Yeah, you can check us all out on our website, artschoolrejects.com, and, you know, find us on iTunes, SoundCloud, and
all that stuff.
You know, that's where we're at. So thank you guys. And, you know, I think, this is a good pot.
For sure. Get home safe.
Safely pilot your USS Callister.
Yeah. Was that gunshots? Oh, I thought it was gunshots.
It's dolphin noises, bro.
I'm into it. Yeah.